I'd like to introduce our panelists, our presenters today. I'd like to introduce to you Mary Jane Woodger, who's presenting on the topic Latter-day Saint Historical Commitment to Religious Liberty in the Cook Islands. Let me introduce her to you. Mary Jane is a professor of church history and doctrine at Brigham Young University. She was born and raised in American Fork and the Salt Lake City, Utah area. Mary Jane has always had a great love for teaching, researching, and writing. Dr. Woodger has written and published over 20 books, including three books about the life and teachings of David O. McKay, as well as a book on the timely subject of self-esteem. She has also authored a number of articles on doctrine, historical and educational subjects. Dr. Woodger has been awarded a number of prestigious awards across our academic community, including the Best Article of the Year Award for the Utah Historical Society, the Brigham Young University Faculty Women's Association Teaching Award. Sister Woodger's current research interests include 20th century church history and Latter-day Saint women history and church education.
It's wonderful to have Craig introduce me because he and I spent a lot of time in the London Missionary Archives, and a lot of what I'm going to say he was a great help with. So, one occurrence of denying religious freedom began in the mid-1800s in the South Pacific Islands, specifically in the Cook Islands, when Christianity was introduced by the London Missionary Society. Not long after the LMS first introduced Christianity in the South Pacific region, the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints began sending missionaries to the islands. Local LMS representatives saw the Latter-day Saints as competition and pressured the government of the Cook Islands to limit the activity of the Latter-day Saint missionaries. There are two ways that religious freedom was denied in the Cook Islands. First was the infiltration of the Cook Islands government by the LMS. As the LMS began to have more and more influence on the government, certain limitations, restrictions, and laws curtailed the religious freedom for other churches and denominations. Secondly, prejudice, bigotry, biases, and discrimination were displayed by individuals belonging to the LMS towards Latter-day Saints who did not conform to their expectations. This organic movement was not instigated by the government or LMS clergy, but it was largely a result of the influence LMS had on Cook Island government leaders. Oh, I forgot, I have this. There, I've caught up. The founders of the LMS never intended to curtail the religious freedom of another Christian religion. The original purpose of the LMS was to spread Christianity and distribute the Bible without advocating any particular Christian denomination. However, it became an official religious denomination in the Cook Islands in 1852, when the Cook Islands LMS Church was established. When the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints Society Islands mission expanded to include the Cook Islands in 1898, President Daniel Thomas Miller turned his attention to the 8,000 people living on the Cook Islands and assigned Elder Widsoe and Elder Davis as the area's first Latter-day Saint missionaries. These first Latter-day Saint missionaries found that the LMS-created church had grown quickly on the Cook Islands. LMS missionaries also established a firm hold on the government within the Cook Islands by converting and sometimes marrying into the strongest Arakis, persons born into nobility and power. Because the kings and the queens converted to the religion, they required the same of their subjects. One queen forbade anyone to attend any church besides the LMS. Slowly but surely, all Cook Islanders began to attend LMS meetings. There were harsh penalties, and the lack of religious freedom made missionary work very difficult. Perhaps this influence from royalty is why the LMS became an official religion in the Cook Islands, but not on any other Pacific islands. This church was affiliated with the LMS until 1965. In 1965, it became an autonomous institution called the Cook Island Christian Church. From its inception, the Cook Island LMS Church heavily influenced the government on the islands, leading to the persecution of Latter-day Saints and those of other religions. Of the major Polynesian island groups, the Cook Islands were the last to receive the focus of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. Robert L. Simpson, a former New Zealand mission president, called the Cook Islands the orphans of the Pacific. Although church leaders and missionaries visited the Cook Islands in the early 1900s, it would not be until after World War II that a permanent mission was established to labor in the Cook Islands. The initial work of the LMS in bringing the Bible to the Cook Islands and improving the people's standard of living enabled the Cook Islands LMS Church to flourish. In addition, it paved the way for the introduction of other Christian denominations, including the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. However, at the same time that the LMS facilitated the introduction of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, it also hindered the church's progress because it led to the persecution of Latter-day Saints. When Latter-day Saints began to have some conversion success in the Cook Islands, the islanders reacted adversely. For instance, Fitz Krueger, an influential Latter-day Saint missionary, faced heavy persecution in the Cook Islands. Krueger moved to Rarotonga in the Cook Islands to open a bakery in 1939 and was called by Mission President Matthew Calley, who called Krueger to do missionary work in the Cook Islands. Although Krueger found some success, opposition from the LMS was imminent. After hearing that there was a Latter-day Saint among them, the LMS began giving out hundreds of pamphlets about Krueger being a devil teacher. These pamphlets urged islanders to cease buying his bread. Sales dropped for a time, and so did the number of people willing to talk to Krueger about the church. However, after reading one of these pamphlets, one Seventh-day Adventist named Harry Toria Strickland came to the bakery with a desire to know more about the church. After a long discussion about Christ's teachings, Strickland was converted and returned home to tell his wife what he'd learned. About a month later, he was baptized along with his family in the fall of 1942. Another early convert, Manu Cummings, was introduced to the church while he was a member of the London Missionary Society. In fact, he and his siblings were strong supporters of the society. At one point, Cummings desired to become a pastor and planned to travel to Tacoma to receive training, but he gave the opportunity to another man. When he married a Catholic, the couple had five children. The family was introduced to the church in 1944 and was baptized later that year by Krueger, along with 14 other converts. Cummings' brother and sister mocked him, calling him names for joining the church rather than remaining in the LMS tradition. Although ridiculed for his decision, Cummings remained firm and became a pillar of the church. By June of 1946, there were 37 members on Rarotonga. Another hindrance to the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints and its members having religious freedom continued to come from the strong influence that the LMS had on the government of the Cook Islands. For instance, in 1950, at an LMS General Assembly meeting, LMS leaders petitioned the Cook Islands government to enforce LMS religious guidelines. Not only did the LMS Church petition the Cook Islands government to uphold its religious values and practices, but it also warned LMS members of the threat of other religions, including the Latter-day Saints. In an attempt to uphold the religious traditions of their ancestors in the LMS Church, the Cook Island LMS Church leaders portrayed other religions as a threat. When discussing the importance of LMS schools, LMS members urged leaders to focus on the schools, if only to prevent the future leadership of the Cook Islands from falling with the hands of the Roman Catholics, Seventh-day Adventists, who had already established such schools, and the Mormons, who have declared their intention of establishing other schools. These examples represent some of the attitudes that leaders of the Cook Islands LMS Church held in the 1950s regarding other religions, including the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. In 1958, the Cook Island government imposed restrictions on the number of LDS missionaries in the Cook Islands. With 22 LDS missionaries, an LMS representative wrote, quote, "This LMS representative suggested limiting the number of Latter-day Saint missionaries in the Cook Islands by instituting a maximum ratio of missionaries to adherents. While the majority of LMS members and ministers were friendly, This friendliness seemed to vanish whenever gospel topics arose. Deacons from the LMS would often initiate heated arguments with missionaries, which in turn caused Cook Islanders to be weary of the missionaries' message. London Missionary Society members would throw rocks at church members' homes, and ministers confronted the missionaries as to why they were trying to steal away the LMS flock. LMS united efforts against the church in a way that seemed impossible to overcome, forbidding any of their members to listen to the missionaries. Sometimes, when the missionaries approached the people, the islanders would cut off the missionaries by saying, "Araya kai papua." All right, I am not sure what I was saying, but it means teach the heathens, go to papaya. For the Cook Islanders, religion was strongly tied to their culture and their family tradition. Anyone who listened to the missionaries risked being identified by their neighbors, monitored and ridiculed in hopes to preserve their traditions. This pressure from LMS ministers, friends, and family made it more difficult for interested Cook Islanders to investigate the church. My Ma, Tom, for example, wanted to meet with the missionaries, but was staying with her uncle, who was an LMS pastor. When she saw the missionaries arrive outside the house, she feared her uncle would be angry. Grandson of an LMS minister, Mata Tumatoa, pushed through the persecution and joined the church at the age of 15. But he explained that hardship that came along with his choice, quote, "The LMS is the thing you don't change, because if you do, people will talk." Even for some church members, social pressures and cultural traditions seem to prevail over religion, especially in marriages and partnerships. After young female members of the church entered into a relationship with someone of the LMS faith, they would often attend their partner's worship service, quickly becoming inactive. In the 1960s, panicked by the rapid baptisms into the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints in that area, LMS ministers quickly translated thousands of anti-Mormon pamphlets into Maori and shipped them to the islands in an attempt to stint missionary efforts. When Taihua Napura drew the elders into his home, he gathered his family around and retrieved a box full of these anti-Mormon pamphlets. Wanting to know if the content of the pamphlets was true, he told the missionaries, quote, "It's a bad spirit that comes from these. I don't believe they're real. I want to know the truth." The missionaries taught him, and Napur and his family were baptized in 1964. Napur's children, parents, his wife's parents, aunts, and uncles on both sides were all baptized, and these baptisms led to the branch of the church being established on the island of Manihiki. Napur eventually became the branch president. Over all the islands, these same kinds of experiences were happening with the anti-Mormon literature printed with the intent to deter the church's rapid growth. In 1963, about 28 people were baptized in the Rarotonga Mission. But by 1964, even with the opposition from the LMS, the Rarotonga Mission had quadrupled, and there was a baptism total of 1,081 people. Many members of the LMS Church had some real issues with the LMS Church's activities and doctrine, but because the LMS Church was deeply involved with the government and wielded so much power over government and politics, many people were forced to accept the status quo. Recognizing that having a state church delimited religious freedom, the Cook Island government made great strides to provide religious freedom for its citizens, providing a possible solution for other countries to use as a pattern. The government established the Cook Islands Religious Advisory Council in 1968, which ensured the representation of different religious affiliations in the Cook Islands government. Now in the Cook Islands, there are six acknowledged religions that receive governmental support: the CICC, the Seventh-day Adventist Church, the Catholic Church, us, the Assembly of God, and the Apostolic Church. This council aims to unite the interests of each denomination with government initiatives. With its organizations, much has been done to diminish the Cook Islands government curtailing of religious freedom. Such an organization serves as a wonderful example of a government that has strived to provide religious freedom where it was not allowed historically. Despite the presence of this religious council, some Latter-day Saints in the Cook Islands still face societal pressure and prejudice because of their beliefs and do not enjoy religious freedom in its entirety. Today, the denial of religious freedom is not coming from government entities, but rather from individuals who, through prejudice, bias, and discrimination, feel that converts to the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints are denying their cultural identity. Because the CICC still is the dominant religion in the Cook Islands today, comprising 49% of the population, it's often a challenge for members of the Church, comprising only 4.4% of the population, to diverge from what is so widely practiced. Most Latter-day Saint converts were formerly members of the CICC. For example, Latter-day Saint Naga Manapouri said that before she converted to the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, she was a member of the CICC, simply because that was the only church they had. The close relationship that exists between the Cook Islands and membership in the Cook Island Christian Church has established an identity for many islanders. It's hard for them to distinguish a difference between cultural identity and religiosity. Therefore, it is often seen that if a person leaves the CICC, he or she is also abandoning the Cook Island nationality. Though joining the church certainly does not change the DNA of its converts, many equate becoming a Latter-day Saint to leaving the Cook Island culture, identity, and family. And for this reason, many islanders are ostracized and rejected when they become Latter-day Saints. Apart from occasional blatant attacks on Latter-day Saints, Matu Tumatua explained that the prejudice against Latter-day Saints was often evident in subtle societal pressure rather than being expressed openly. From what he noticed, prejudice was shown in the expression of surprise and the questioning that Latter-day Saint converts frequently received from family members and friends. Although there is still some societal pressure on a personal level, religious persecution on a societal level has gradually diminished, and now, for the most part, there is mutual public respect between the various religions on the islands. Nigel Nagatukanatua, Latter-day Saint Bishop in Aitutaki, explained that if there is a problem, it is usually in small groups, but there are no large-scale issues between denominations. He shared, "I have a great relationship with the three ministers of the CICC Church on this island. What I mean is we should shake hands, we'll have a little conversation, have a chat, have a laugh, you know? There's no issue. And I think there's a certain level of respect that we have for each other. It was right back in the day, I think. Boy, I should have spell checked this. If any religion was to come in or them to stamp their authority and say, this is our territory, but now it's not quite like that as far as I know." Angora Williams had a similar experience in her interactions with the Cook Islands Religious Advisory Council. "We'd go to activities, they'd come to the house, but there was no friction between different denominations. The council serves to unite the interests of the different denominations with the government. One of the ways in which the council achieves this is by conducting national religious events. For instance, each year, the council organizes a large church service at the beginning of cyclone season to invite Cook Islanders to enjoy a spiritual program and pray together for the nation. Then, at the end of the cyclone season, the council hosts another session of Thanksgiving. While this council has functioned, the various denominations have become more united, and the government has been more supportive of Latter-day Saints." While the Cook Islands Religious Advisory Council With the Cook Islands Religious Advisory Council, the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints has become more accepted in the Cook Islands. However, not all members of other religions are in support of Latter-day Saints. Matura Cummings stated, quote, "There are some that are against it and some that are with it, but the prejudice that remains is what prevents religious freedom from being experienced by Latter-day Saints in its entirety within the Cook Islands." Religious freedom is not completely prevalent in the Cook Islands, yet such freedom is a high priority for Latter-day Saints. Latter-day Saint leaders assert that religious freedom includes more than just the freedom of what to believe. It also includes other aspects of how to worship. Finally, religious freedom includes the freedom to do missionary work. Apostle Robert D. Hales explained, quote, "A cornerstone of religious freedom is the freedom to share our faith and our beliefs with others. As parents, full-time missionaries, and member missionaries, we rely on religious freedom in order to teach the Lord's doctrine in our families and throughout the world. For Latter-day Saints to fully act on their beliefs, They must have the freedom to preach the gospel, do missionary work throughout the world. When Latter-day Saints first arrived in the Cook Islands, they were deprived of religious freedom. They were persecuted by members of the LMS. Their activities were restricted by the Cook Island government, and they faced an overall negative pressure from a society that continues in some degree today. We cannot conclude that members of the LMS or CICC had malicious intentions in their attitudes and actions towards Latter-day Saints. It is more likely that LMS members treated Latter-day Saints this way out of support for their own causes and beliefs, and they truly thought it was for the good of the island. Violations of religious freedom are usually a result of pride for one's own religion, but even if the LMS or CICC did not mean any harm, the persecution, imposed restrictions, and prevalent societal pressures were violations of religious freedoms. Latter-day Saints were not free to share their beliefs, how they chose, or to build institutions the way they wanted, and they were not treated with the respect and love that Christians are taught to extend to others. The restrictions on religious freedom of Latter-day Saints in the Cook Islands have diminished gradually in the recent years because of the Cook Island Religious Council. But there are still improvements to be made to eliminate societal and cultural pressures that Latter-day Saints feel because of their beliefs. Members of all religions are now feeling more accepted, despite their differences and beliefs, with the formation of this council, which could serve as a great pattern for other areas. Thank you.
I think we've had two excellent presentations, and so we'd like to open up the time now for questions.
Thanks so much for those fantastic papers. I couldn't help but noticing in both papers the intertwining of imperialism, colonialism, and those kinds of practices with belief and culture, which is, of course, a much bigger problem than you can address in, 30 seconds in response to my question. But I just wonder, especially in the Cook Islands, the Polynesian Islands were being so heavily colonized at the time the missionaries arrived, and the LMS being there is also, of course, not just a religious practice. It's also a political game for the British, and, this is happening throughout the Pacific. And I wonder to what extent that is present in the records of the conversions, like to what extent people are recognizing that in choosing one religion over another, they're also choosing one country or one culture over another and over their own indigenous practices as part of this, sort of complicated negotiation.
We didn't run into a lot of that. And I think the reason is because those kings and queens joined. And so they didn't see it as colonization or going against cultural practices or loyalty to, Great Britain or the Cook Islands, and I think that's why it became a denomination, the Cook Islands, and it didn't other places, because the royalty enforced it. And so it wasn't seen as adopting anything else. It was just seen as supporting your local royalty. And so I don't, Craig, did you see anything about that as you went through the records? And we didn't see that. There was a lot of LMS and Samoa records, and I didn't see it there either. Yeah, great question. Thank you.
Well, our time is up for questions. We'd like to thank our panelists. Can we give them one big hand? Thank you.